Testing, testing. Right. Hi, guys. Again. thank you for coming. Here we have Bernardt today. He works at Brickelt. He builds chatbots using machine learning for a living. He's been doing this for roughly 2 years. Today he's going to talk to us about fast random number generation with Python. And without further ado, Bernardt.
Thank you. Okay, you heard who I am. I work at a company called Brickelt Consulting. A lot of you might know the Brickelt Foundation, now called Brickelt.org as well, which is the non-profit leg of the company. So I'll firstly just present how to generate a random number, and I'll start that with exactly what is a random number. But I'm sure most of you have used random numbers, so you should be fairly familiar with the concept. And I'll show how to do it in Python and NumPy. So to generate a random number, one might use a dice. Now, one thing I'm not sure about is whether it's die or dice for singular. Is it die for singular? Okay, my apologies if it's incorrect in the presentation. So if you have a fair dice or an unbiased dice, you can generate the uniform random number within a certain range. So you might get a three-sided dice or a four-sided dice, and you can generate numbers in those ranges using these dice. I should have perhaps put up an image of a larger image of a three-sided dice. I found it was really oddly shaped to give you those three sides. But let's say, given these dice, how would you generate now a number, a uniform random number, in a range 1 to 15, inclusive? Please. Say again. So let's say you roll a 1 to 20, a 20-sided dice, then you'll get numbers between 1 and 20 inclusive. But you actually want a range of 1 to 15. Will that be uniform distribution? So one way to do it, yeah? Reroll. Okay. One way to do it might be to do what's called rejection sampling, where you roll the 1 to 20 dice, and if the number is more than 15, you just roll it again until you get a number. Until you get a number that's within that range. So that's called rejection sampling. Now, one could also use some math and a computer to do this. In that case, it's called a pseudo-random number, because it's kind of a machine starting from a specific point generating random numbers. So you typically have to seed it to start at some point, and you can reseed it to start at a different point. But you can use a program to generate a sequence of random numbers. And the known algorithms to do this is like the linear congruential generator, Mersenne Twister, XOR shift, or PCG. So some of these names should sound familiar to you at least. And these kind of give you numbers in the binary word ranges. So it's maybe 0 to 2 to the 16 non-inclusive, or 0 to 2 to 64 non-inclusive. And then I pose the same question: how do you now generate a uniform random number within, for example, 1 to 15? That is one option, yes. And I'll get to that option, and then you can tell me whether that's biased or not. I'll get back to this question, but I just want to give you some details on how a random number generator works. And one of the simplest ones is this linear congruential generator. And typically, its formula looks something like this, where the next random number, that x underscore n plus n, is equal to the previous random number multiplied by some constant, typically they add a constant to this as well, and then they mod it by some number m. If m is in the range, is value 2 to the 32, for example, then we get some of the well-known generators that you would find in numerical recipes or maybe in libc. And at least that bottom one was in Visual Studio at some point. I'm not sure if it's still, if that's still the numbers that the constants are implemented there. And the cool thing is that given enough bits, these generators actually pass statistical tests quite well. If you are interested in this, there's a cool blog, BCG Random, that has one post, does it beat the minimal standard, which goes into some detail. And for example, the Mersenne Twister doesn't pass all of the big crush tests, but just about all of them. And a special case of the linear congruential generator is the multiplicative congruential generator, where the one constant, that C, is now zero. And again, when you get to larger bit ranges, the 128-bit one, for example, I should have stated that you take the 128-bit version and you just use the upper 64 bits. So you shift it right 64 bits, and then that 64-bit result is the one that passes the big crush tests. And in this case, M in this formula is to the 128, as I mentioned, and the constant that you would use, that A value, is this very long 128-bit value. And there's a paper from 1999, if you're interested, they list a whole bunch of these constants on which constants work well for which generators, so you can go and have a look. And this one as well passes big crush. It's also mentioned in that same, does it beat the minimal standard blog or post on that blog. And there are other ones as well. I've mentioned the Mersenne Twister, Excel Shift, and BCG. The Mersenne Twister was developed in 1997, and it's still very popular. That's probably the one that most people know and that most people use. It has one problem with it, has a bit of a large memory footprint. I think something like 2,500 bytes of memory that you need to do this generator. And that's because it generates a random state and then works from that state for a bit, and then it regenerates that state. Excel Shift was developed in 2003. Now this has a much smaller footprint, and it is a little bit faster than the Mersenne Twister as well. Then in 2014, the permuted congruential generator was developed. So you can see some of these generators were developed quite recently. It's, there has been a lot of development since Mersenne Twister in 1997. And there's an excellent talk by Melissa O'Neill, the developer of BCG. If you just Google for Melissa O'Neill at Stanford, she's not from Stanford, but she gave a talk at Stanford. And she goes through the history of random numbers, how it works, how the modern generators work. And what's important to note for this talk is that the Mersenne Twister is pretty fast. You can get a new random number in I think something like 10 machine cycles, and the BCG is about double that performance. So every 5 cycles, you can get a new random number. And just if anyone's wondering where these numbers are, these pseudo random number generators are used, of course, if you don't have a die with you, then you could use an algorithm to give you a random result. Or pretty much any a simulation of any physical system. But most of those systems are quite complex, so it seems random in nature, and you would use random numbers in the simulation. And then mostly where I use it is if you are searching high-dimensional spaces. So that's why I started this investigation, to be able to do those types of searches and initializations faster. And that brings us back to the question I posed a bit earlier on given the pseudo-random number generators, how do you generate a number within a specific range? Because they all kind of give you within the binary word ranges. So they do quite fast, but you often want a number in some smaller range to work with. So just to state it a bit more formally, we want to, given this random number in 0 to some power of 2, generate a uniform random number in a smaller range. So I'll use Rn for that smaller ranged random number. And we kind of know that the Mersenne Twister takes about 10 clock cycles, the PCG about 5, and the MCG, the multiplicative congruential generator, takes about 3 cycles. So that's the fastest one. So generating a number in a smaller range should ideally not take much longer than that. It should be of a similar performance. And that's the kind of the focus of this presentation, is how do you generate these random numbers in an interval fast? How do you do that part of the calculation well? So one approach is to do a mod s. Now, this is a method that's used often. It's quite a simple method. And I'll give an example. Let's say you take a random number, you mod it by 3. This is kind of the range you get. You get numbers between 0 and 1 inclusive, 0 and 2 inclusive. And if you were to imagine that you started out with a random number in the range 0 to 2 to the 3, still using a scale of 3, then these the numbers 0 to 7 would be all of the numbers that you'll get from your random number generator. So 2 to the 3 is 8. And the generator, in other words, generates numbers from 0 to 7 inclusive. And if you were to mod that, you would get for 0 mod 3 would be 0. And if you go all the way, 2 mod 3 would be 2. But then it starts wrapping around until they get to 5 mod 3, which is again 2. But these last 6 mod 3 and 7 mod 3 give you a 0 and a 1. And you can see in the sequence, then 0 and 1 appears more often than the 2. So this works, but it's not uniform. There's some bias. That should be clear to everyone. So how efficient is this approach? Does anyone know what the cost of a mod or a divide is? Yeah, it does depend on the hardware, does depend on the number range. It's around 20 to 50 cycles, depending on what you're doing. So if you were to take a random number, it was generated in, say, 5 cycles, and apply this, you would end up at a much more expensive random number generator. So the first question is, can we correct for the bias? Is there some way to make this a uniform random number generator? And typically what's done is to add some rejection sampling, as we mentioned initially, where, taking that same example, if your random number is in that upper range, that's not a within a complete multiple of the scale, in this case 6 and 7, you reject those numbers, which means you reject the bias, this last 0 and 1 that would have made the generator biased or non-uniform. And this is what the while loop looks like. If your random number generator is within this small upper range, then you simply reject the sample and you try again. And then finally, you have to do another mod, because you now have a X in the correct range, but you still have to, you have an X in the 2 to the L range, but you still have to scale it down to range 0 to S. So that's another mod that you have to do. So this is uniform, but now we kind of have two mods, and we're rejecting some samples. So it's a little more expensive, but at least it's uniform. And this approach is still often used in simple random number generators like your C++ or your C rand function, those simple included ones. There's another approach called masking and rejection sampling. So in this case, we're kind of trying to avoid that mod because we know that's an expensive operation, and we know we can use rejection sampling to correct for any bias. So in this case, we're generating a new random number in a smaller range for m such that 2 to the m is bigger or equal to s. So you want to take that smallest binary word possible that's just larger than s, so that if you have to do any rejection above your scale, your s, it's the smallest possible fraction that you have to reject. So this is what the math looks like, where you can now, because it's a binary number, the mod becomes an AND operation with all of the bits set, so AND with 2 to the m minus 1. That's kind of key that you can replace the mod with an AND, which is a single clock cycle. And then the rejection loop looks similar, where if it's larger or equal to s, we reject the sample, and we sample a new number. The problem with this approach is now the number of samples that we reject. So because we're choosing a binary word range to generate that initial x in random number, and we still only want a number that's smaller than that range, and whenever the number is bigger, you would reject it. In worst case, if m were equal to 11, for example, and the range you were looking for is 1025, then 2 to the m minus 1, plus 1, because it's an open range, would be 2048. So if you just want a number between 0 and 1025, and you have a range of 0 to 2048, you have to reject about 50% of your sample. So worst case, there's no mod, but you're rejecting 50% of your samples, which kind of brings your performance from down from the two mod case to about, say, 6 to 20 cycles. So it's a fairly good approach. This is what NumPy does. And then integer scaling was mentioned, where you can generate a number x in that binary word range, but you want to calculate a scaled number, that is that random number multiplied by some scale. And if you then shift this number by the binary word size, you are guaranteed that the number, this RN, is in the range that you're looking for. So how efficient is this approach? It's very efficient because it's 1 64-bit multiplication, which is one cycle these days, and it's a shift, which is one cycle, so it's really efficient. And the question is this uniform? Of course, the answer must be no, because I'm only on slide 14. But I'll show you why. So let's take again the example where you have a scale of 3 and a binary word range of 2 to the L. So it's again generating initial random numbers from 0 to 7 inclusive. If you scale that by 3, you get numbers, scaled integers in the range 0 to 24. And 0 scales to 0, 7 scales to 21. So it's you don't get all of the numbers within this range, but that's your new scale, and I've underlined the numbers that are actually now included that you might get. So if your original random number was a 2, you would now get times 3, which is a 6. Is that clear? And if we then divide by the binary or the random word size, so if you divide by 3, so remember we're working with binary numbers between that are in the range of 0 to 2 to the 3, then you get this result where numbers from 0 to 7 are included in your first bin, your first division bin, and that would result in a RN of 0. And numbers that are in the second, the numbers 8 to 15 are in your second bin, and numbers 16 to 23 is in your third bin. And you can kind of notice that the first bin has 3 numbers from your original sequence, and the second bin also has 3, but the last bin just has 2, so it is unbiased. This is kind of a small example, but you can imagine this for yourself with bigger binary ranges, and you'll see the same result. So again, we can add rejection sampling, of course, because we know that fixes biased random numbers. And this is now, I've started from a paper by Daniel Lemire. It's already available on archive, but it's not yet published. It's still to appear in Transactions on Modeling Simulation. Where if we take that same example, we can now decide to reject some of those values. And if we know which values to reject, so in this case, let's say we reject the first 2 in each bin, then we end up with 2 random numbers in each of the bins, and then it's a uniform generator. And we can kind of know that we can reject these first 2 because that's the size of the random word mod by the scale of your random number generator. So there's still one mod in there, but at least now it's uniform. And the chance of rejecting a number is dependent on the scale that you want. So for small scales, it's a very small probability of rejecting a number. But as you go to larger scales, there's a higher probability of rejecting a number. But I want to show the algorithm that appears in the paper. Now, I have mentioned much of this. I'll just walk you through it quickly. So we know we need. Do we have a laser pointer? Okay. So we know on that second line, we need a random number in a certain interval, and we're starting out with a scale. The scale is between 0 and 2 to the L. So we get an initial random number that's x, which is in that bigger range. We multiply x by the scale, which, thank you. We multiply x by the scale, and as we've done before, to get the m, the scaled random number, and then we have this, it's called the leftover value, which is that scaled number modded by your range of the initial random number. And there is the mod that I spoke about, that the single mod that still remains in this method. But, I suggest you read through a paper, it's quite interesting. This S, the scale itself, is in this case an upper bound for the value that you computed using the mod. So you don't always have to compute the mod. There's a simple method, and a simple upper bound that you can test against first. So in most cases, you would generate your initial random number, you would scale that, you would check this leftover value, and it's likely that the leftover, because it is also just a random number, it's likely that it's smaller than S, if S is not too big, then you would not execute this, and you would just divide by your binary range. So you're back to the scaled integer case for most executions of this, and in a small fraction of the time you have to execute the mod, but that seems to be fine for average use. I did mention that we are now dividing by a power of 2, so that's kind of efficient to do. Just one instruction instead of one cycle instead of 20. S is upper bound, which you can test again, and S doesn't change as you reject values. So it's a single mod, it's never more than one mod that you have to do. T is only dependent on S, so you also don't have to recalculate the T value. And this is what the mod behavior looks like. So the top red line is typically the two mod approach that Java, the OpenBSD, yes, the OpenBSD implements. I'm not sure if they still use this method, but the simple implementation at least used to be this. Then Java implements a slight alternative where they have at least one mod, and then at most infinite number of mods, but they have one mod plus one mod per sample that's rejected. And then the bottom one is Lemire's algorithm, which for most cases would not have a mod, so the performance impact, the probability of having that mod is pretty low. And this is the core of why this algorithm is faster. I'll show you the results just now, but before I do that, Python uses the mod plus rejection approach. NumPy, so Python also uses masking plus rejection when I want to generate an array of numbers. But NumPy uses masking and rejection mainly. And I initially did a PR to NumPy for implementing Lemire's method, and Charles Harris pointed me to a NumPy enhancement proposal, which I didn't know about before, but which has to do with the history of Python's random number generator, that it had to be had to produce exactly the same results. It has to produce the same results now as it did at some time ago. But he then pointed me to random gen, which attempts to fix that. And Kevin Shepard from random gen seemed quite keen to accept the PR, so I'm at the moment busy with that. We're testing it for 64-bit. There's some conditional code paths on the Windows that you have to do, and for 32-bit architectures that you have to go through. But this is the NumPy enhancement proposal. If anyone's interested, it's quite a cool read, especially if you use NumPy and random numbers a lot. And some quick details on random gen. The random generators are implemented in C, so it's a Cython system. And they have a whole number of generators, which include the Mersenne Twister, XL Shift, PCG, FreeFly, and FreeLox. These last two, I don't know. I don't know if anyone has worked with FreeFly and FreeLox. So the results, the yellow line is Lemire's algorithm, and the blue and the green is NumPy and random gen before this algorithm was added. So you can see this shows numbers in millions per second, so higher is faster. You can see in the worst case, in the best case for NumPy, Lemire's algorithm is a little bit slower, but because of the rejection sampling, on average, it's a lot better than NumPy and in general the masking plus rejection, because when you get certain numbers like 1025 or 2049, anything that's one bigger than your binary range, you get this dip in performance as it's rejecting 50% of the numbers. And on average, by my calculation, it improves the performance, reduces the execution time by 54%. And in the worst case, in these dips, it's about, it reduces the execution time by 73%. I'm running out of time a little bit, but this is what the random gen benchmark produces. So this to show you that the Mersenne Twister is what's in NumPy. So this compares random gen to NumPy. And there are generators that are faster than Mersenne Twister. The PCG and the 32 and 64 are good modern alternatives to Mersenne Twister. And if you look at the speed up with Lemire's algorithm, then it's 85% speed up, so it's almost double. This is an approximate average case. It's almost double in this case. And some of the other ones perform quite a lot better than NumPy's Mersenne Twister default. So this is also kind of an example of why you can look at random gen if you really want to generate random numbers fast. Because in the best case, you can look at speed ups of 400%. That's five times. And luckily, there's been a confirmation of my results. It's not just me that's measured this. There was another post on the SpeciG random blog on bounded random numbers, and they measured that if you used a faster random number generator, the underlying random number generator, you can get up to 45%, in this case, a reduction in execution time. But if you used Lemire's method, you could get a 66% reduction in execution time. So it's again, it's more than double performance. So hopefully when this goes into random gen and eventually into NumPy, you'll all be able to generate numbers at least twice as fast as you can generate numbers now. Thank you.
We do have a few minutes for questions. Any question?
Hello. Interesting talk. I have a lot of questions or comments. Maybe I can just reduce myself to a few. Line 2 of that algorithm has a potential bug in it. I assume you are making sure that multiplication is in double precision. Otherwise, you risk overflow.
Yes. This algorithm.
Yes.
So M becomes a 128-bit number.
Right.
And X, it's integers, but the X and the S are both 32-bit.
Right.
If you are generating 32-bit numbers, and then M becomes a 64-bit number.
Right.
The CPUs these days can actually do a 64-bit times a 64-bit number and give you a 128-bit number.
Yes, yes. Usually in two registers.
Yeah. So that is an important thing to take note of.
Another comment around this algorithm is I think I remember this being described by Knuth in volume 2. So I don't know if this is an improvement on the algorithm described there or if it's a rediscovery.
I will have to go and investigate. It's unfortunately not my algorithm.
Yes, I know that.
I'll go and have a look. Yeah. I'm just presenting the implementation of this.
It's quite a clever algorithm.
Yeah.
And then, is anyone else?
We can chat afterwards. So.
What led you to, were you just like, I can't get this thing faster. I will look at random number generation and see if I can speed that up. Like.
Well, I take part in coding competitions sometimes, and there, if you can do a random search faster than someone else, it in some cases helps you. So
cool.
If you can do that double as fast, it does in some cases help.
Okay, that's cool.
But in general, whenever you want to search using some type of random search, this is very useful. As long as nothing else is slower than this part. Yeah.
Okay, with my question, what I want to ask is for a non-mathematician, at what point is the built-in Python random generator not good enough?
I'm not sure if it has to do with whether you're a mathematician or not. So it's whenever you want random numbers faster than you can get it now. There are cases, for example, I mentioned the case of doing a random search where generating those random numbers is the slowest part, and then you would need a faster algorithm. If you are doing some computation as well and the random number generation is not the slowest part, then you won't need an optimized version. It's basically Amdahl's law where you have to focus on the part that you can optimize, or that the slowest part.
So one of the features that Mersenne Twister's one of its upsides is that it has a very long period. How does that compare with these newer generators?
So I'm not really familiar. I'm not an expert on random number generation yet. I'm just a user of it. Melissa O'Neill does talk about that in her video. This method of rejection sampling you can apply, of course, to the Mersenne Twister to make that faster as well.
Yeah, I think more but about the sort of PCG you were talking about.
Yes. The one failure on the Mersenne Twister that I recall is there's a test for linearity in the sequences. And apparently the Mersenne Twister fails that, where other generators like the linear congruential generator passes. But yeah, to be honest, I think the Mersenne Twister has thousands of bits, 2 to the power of thousands in cycle.
Cool. And I think we're out of, one more.
Thank you. Sorry, I don't want to usurp the speaker, but I can actually answer the two previous questions.
Please do.
The reason why you want a very long period is if you're using parallel programming for, say, a Monte Carlo simulation, you are literally going to be running thousands of simultaneous threads generating random numbers, and you don't want there to be any overlap in those subsets that you're generating. And the way you do that is by having an astronomically long period for your random number generator. And that is also the reason why you actually want the random number generator to be as fast as possible, because you're having to do thousands of threads simultaneously, and each one is generating millions of random number generators in order for you to get a decent result.
I can maybe just add on that, some of the modern generators support what is known as streams, splitting. So in some cases, Mersenne Twister might just be too large a state for your purpose, and then you might want to use some of the more modern, Bruce, you asked the question, some of the more modern generators that supports streams.
Right. I think that's about it. Thank you very much, Bernardt. We really appreciated learning.
Thank you.